Everybody, I'd like to welcome you all to Oasis this morning. So as we make our way to our seats, let us remember that today is Father's Day, and who is our Heavenly Father? Of course, God. So we should just continue to give praise and thanks and worship our Heavenly Father for everything that He's given to us, everything He's done for us. And with that, we'll go ahead and begin with our songs. Today is Father's Day, and one of the lines in the song that I just love says, "Who makes the orphan a son and daughter?" And on this Father's Day, I just want to give glory and give thanks to our Father, our Heavenly Father, who has made us His sons and daughters, and just how amazing is that? And so as we just reflect on that truth and just reflect on the fact that He so loved us that He sent His Son for us and that He desires to call us his children. Let's just sing this next song, How He Loves, and just be reminded of how incredibly much the Lord loves us. He is jealous for me, loves like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us all. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us all.
There's nothing worth us experience the glory of your goodness. As we come more aware of your presence, let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. In your presence, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. Should be
continue to just guide us and speak to us, Father, in everything that we do and all that we learn from you, Father. May you continue to just shine through our hearts, shine in all of our lives, Father. And I pray that you help us to understand what it is that is to be preached today, Father. And again, as we sang, as we prayed right now, Lord God, Holy Spirit, come fill this atmosphere and come fill our hearts, Father, so that we can be more open to you and more understanding of you, Father, and everything that Alex is going to teach us today, Lord. So thank you again just so much for everything, Father, and I love you and I praise you, Father. In your son's beautiful name I pray, amen.
I said today we're gonna look at things that really life when it doesn't make sense, when it seems to go well for others, but it's not going well for us. So we're gonna take a look at that today and really how today's text applies to us. So if you will, take God's one and only written word, like it says up on the screen, turn your Bible to the book of Luke. We're in the 8th chapter, we're gonna be in the 40th verse. And we're just gonna look a little bit at some of these verses and see how it applies to our lives. So, Luke chapter 8, verse 40. Now again, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, it's in that order in the New Testament. So, Luke chapter 8, verse 40. Give me an amen so I know you're with me. Amen. Amen, that sounds pretty healthy and hearty. So, I'll give a moment for the rest of you guys to catch up, but here we are, Luke chapter 8, verse 40. And it says this in verse 40, it says, now when Jesus returned, a crowd welcomed him, for they were all expecting him. Now let's just backtrack. Where have we been the last 2 weeks? What did he return from? Well, 2 weeks ago, he left on a little boat trip across the Sea of Galilee. And remember when he was in the middle, a storm came, everybody freaked out. They woke Jesus up. They said, Jesus, we're gonna flood. We're gonna drown. We're gonna die. Jesus got up and just somehow calmed the storm. And it just subsided and everybody was amazed. Last week, we talked about how he finally made it over to the other end, the other side of the Sea of Galilee, and how he was approached by a demon-possessed man right off the boat, and how Jesus, in his power, in his ability, in just his divinity, healed the man who was demon-possessed, and therefore a miracle took place then and there. Now, this week we see Jesus returning from that boat trip, and here he is back on the original side of the Sea of Galilee, and we're about to see two miracles take place. So, verse 41 says this, that then, after he returned, a man named Jairus, A ruler of the synagogue came and fell at Jesus' feet, pleading with them to come to his house because his only daughter, a girl of about 12, was dying. Imagine being a parent and your child, who should outlive you, is actually dying well before she should. Just imagine, put yourself in there. What would you be feeling? How desperate would you become? It goes on and it says, as Jesus was on his way, the crowds almost crushed him. Imagine that. Imagine being in such a crowd that it's just about to crush you physically. How many people that must have been. And verse 43 says, and a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. All right, 12 years she was subject to bleeding, but no one could heal her. How desperate has she become? She came up behind him, referring to Jesus, and she touched the edge of his cloak, and immediately her bleeding stopped like that. Wow. And Jesus asked this. He said, who touched me? And when they all denied it, Peter said, Master, the people are crowding and pressing against you. And Jesus said, someone has touched me. I know that power has gone out from me. Then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, came trembling and fell at his feet. In the presence of all the people, she told why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. And then he said to her, daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace. While Jesus was still speaking, someone came from the house of Jairus and the synagogue, who's the synagogue ruler, and he said, your daughter is dead. Don't bother the teacher anymore. Upon hearing this, Jesus said to Jairus, don't be afraid, just believe, and she will be healed. Verse 51 says, when he arrived at the house of Jairus, referring to Jesus, he did not let anyone go in with him except Peter, John, and James, and the child's father and mother. Meanwhile, all the people were wailing and mourning for her. Stop wailing, Jesus said. She's not dead, but asleep. And they all laughed at him, knowing that she was dead. But he took her by the hand and said, my child, get up. And her spirit returned, and at once she stood up. And then Jesus told him to give her something to eat, and her parents were astonished, but he ordered them not to tell anybody what had happened. Interesting piece of text. Interesting, right before our eyes, that two miracles took place. One, it seemed like Jesus wasn't even trying, but a woman touched his cloak. And then the second one, even amongst the ridicule, even amongst people laughing at Jesus, he says, you know what? Watch what my God's about to do. Who my Father, how he's about to move. And sure enough, he heals this first woman, or this second woman, this young girl of 12 years old. You know, it's interesting that when it comes to healing, because I think many of us have prayed for healing, many of us have prayed for the healing of others, that when it comes to healing, Jesus prescribes two key phrases in this Bible. He says in verse 48, he says, it's your faith. He talks about faith being needed in order for healing to take place. In verse 50, he talks about this thing called belief, and he says, just believe and she will be healed. And in verse 55, we see the conclusion of both healings being fulfilled. A woman who, if you think about it, as old as this young 12-year-old girl was, you have this other woman who's been bleeding as long as this girl has been on earth. And yet both of them are suffering. One's 12 years old, one's been suffering for 12 years. We don't know what type of bleeding, we don't know what's going on, but any type of bleeding is bad, right? And so Jesus heals them like that. It's incredible, it's awesome. We look at it and we're like, praise God, Jesus. But you know what? I can't. All week long, as I was preparing the sermon, as I was praying over the text, as I was thinking about the text, as I was just reading and reading the text, it's almost as if the Lord redirected my thoughts. And the question that kept coming to my mind was this: what about me? What about me, God? I read of these healings, what about me? And then I put myself in your shoes and I thought, you might be asking the same question, sitting there, suffering, because I know that if we sit too long, those chairs become uncomfortable. Some have hip pain, some have back pain, some have knee pains. I get this. And so you might be sitting there going through life saying, you know, Lord, I see you healing people, but what about me? Why haven't I been healed yet? Obviously, I believe in the same Jesus who's here. I believe in the same God that this Bible writes about, and yet God seems to heal them instantaneously. Yet what about me? And for some of us, we've probably been suffering more than 12 years, more than 20 years, I don't know. See, we all know how it works, right? We have a pain. Maybe you've been praying for it for weeks, for months, for years. You go to all the Bible studies, you voice your pain, you're that desperate. You put your prayer request on all these prayer chains, and not only are you praying for it, but the church prays for it. Here at Oasis, many of you put your prayer requests on your bulletin on the bottom of that. You write down your prayer request, and week after week, you put it in that offering box, and we pray and we pray, and yet still, it seems that God has not healed you. And we do all this work. And what's the result? So far, nothing's happened. And so we ask that question, why me, God? Why have I not been healed through this? Now, if we're honest with ourselves, we can honestly think that there's, and it doesn't take much, there's always somebody worse off than us, if we're honest. There's always somebody who seems to be suffering a little bit more. But in reality, when we're in the middle of our suffering, guess what? That doesn't really seem to matter. Because my pain is here, my pain is now, and my pain is really real to me. I mean, who couldn't stand up here and give testimony after testimony about pains that you've had over the years? And maybe some of you could stand up here and give testimony of triumph over tragedy. And that would be awesome to hear. But as we pray about it, I was thinking, just even within this church, some of the ailments that we have. Because I was thinking about it, I think that there's people with chronic headaches in this church, people with back pains, people with hand pains, with joint pains, ankles, knees, pelvic pains, hip pains, people with shingles, people with ulcers, cancers, diseases, multiple sclerosis, infections, and even things that the doctors can't tell you why you feel that way. They can't pinpoint where the pain's coming from. Their best answer is, I don't know. And yet you still have to pay for the doctor visit. This type of pain that keeps you up throughout the night and plagues you throughout the day. And yet we ask this, Lord, God, what about me? And I understand that not all pain is physical. There's emotional pain, maybe the pain of a lost one. There's financial pain. Maybe somebody stole money from you. Maybe you went bankrupt. Maybe you're struggling to make ends meet, having to work multiple jobs. And then there's emotional pain, just, you know, a battlefield for the mind. Thoughts you're struggling with, temptations you're wrestling with, there's all types of suffering. And so really, a lot of what today can be attached to many of what you guys are feeling. See, we serve a God who is omnipotent, meaning he's all powerful. The same God who's all powerful is also sovereign, which means he's in control. And yet if our God is in control, and yet if our God is all powerful, why is it that he's not healing me? Why is it that he's not healing my parents? Why is it that he's not healing my aunt or my uncle who has this form of cancer, who's in this type of disease? Well, because it is Father's Day, and now that I am a father, it's been interesting. Because even when my daughter is in pain, I pray and I say, God, put that pain upon me. I hate to see her suffering. There's some natural pain she has to go through, like teething. But yet every time she cries, every time she suffers, I pray, Lord, God, if you can, put that pain upon me. Now, if her earthly father loves her that much, how much more does our heavenly father love his children? How much more does God love us than we can love our children? And we can love our children greatly, so how much more does God love us? Because understand, God is love. Literally, the Bible says God is love, meaning God equals love. Well, if God loves me, why doesn't he heal me? Right? I know I've prayed that prayer, and I've been a Christian for a long time, but when I'm suffering, I pray that prayer, and I ask that question a lot. God, you know I'm suffering, and I know you can heal me, but why, Lord? have you decided not to heal me? Well, what I've done today is I've put together a list of possible reasons why God allows us to suffer. Now, this list is not exhaustive, and there's probably one or two things that you could add to this list maybe. But these are some of the top reasons that I believe that God decides not to heal us, or why God allows suffering to partake in our life. Yeah, it's Father's Day. Yes, we should praise God for a great Father that He is. But if He's so great, why does He allow suffering in our lives? Why me, Lord? Well, the first reason that I think is because of sin. There may be sin in your lives that is affecting you physically. Well, what are you talking about, Alex? Well, first of all, I think of a very common one, sexual immorality, people doing things outside of marriage or before marriage that they shouldn't do. And guess what? When you're sexually immoral, we live in a time and an age where things transfer from one person to another, STD, AIDS, viruses, and guess what? Those have physical effects, things that hurt, things that bring you pain because you decided to partake in sin. There's other things that are sinful that can cause physical pain. If you worry too much, if you fear too much, if you allow bitterness to take deep root in you, if you have anger, guess what? If you're bitter against somebody and you have a lot of anger, and there is I can't fully explain it, but there's something between the sin and the physical where if you dwell on it long enough, if you allow that bitterness to take root long enough, guess what? You become so bitter that it manifests itself in physical ways. Maybe you become angry, maybe you worry so much that it turns into physical with ulcers, with shingles, with just joint pains. All right, maybe you start to get wrinkles when you shouldn't have wrinkles. Maybe you get gray hair long before you're supposed to have gray hair. In fact, up on the screen, it says in James chapter 5, verse 16, look at what it says. It says, therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. See, the reason I put that in is because do we confess our sins to God? Yes, we should. And we do. But there is a power in having an accountability partner. There is a power in being willing to confess your sins to somebody that you trust so that they can hold you accountable and walk alongside with you. And guess what? If they hold you accountable, maybe they can help you dig out through those sins that you're struggling with. So maybe God's allowing physical ailments, physical suffering in your life because there's some unconfessed sin that you'd rather partake in than your relationship with God. Now, the second thing that God may allow for us, or why God may allow suffering in our life, is because God wants to discipline us. God needs to discipline us because He wants to help us and protect us from something else out there. I know people after people, one guy, for example, this guy on fire for the Lord. We'd go out, we'd share the gospel with people every weekend. We'd go out. And I mean, he was on fire. He was just praising God. Anybody he came across, he was just sharing Jesus. But you know what? One day we were supposed to go out. He calls me up and says, Alex, I'm done. I have a migraine. I'll call you later. Bye. I didn't see him for a week. He finally calls me back and says, hey, man, let's get together. We got together. I talked to him. I said, well, what happened? What's going on? He said, you know, I prayed all week and I asked the Lord, why did he allow that to happen? Why did I get this migraine? Because I never get migraines. And he realized that after talking to God, he realized that he was neglecting other areas of his life. His marriage was suffering because he spent more time talking to other people than investing in the people that God had given him in marriage. He spent more time out in other areas than with his own family. And so we started going out, but we didn't go out as much. God had to discipline him physically with a migraine to get his attention, to help him be mindful of all the areas in his life. And so sometimes God disciplines us and allows us to suffer to get our attention. Sometimes it takes that much that God has to sideline us. But look at this, take comfort in this, because in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 6, it says this, because the Lord disciplines those he loves and he punishes everyone he accepts as sons. Listen, if you consider yourself a Christian, be ready to be disciplined by God if you need it. And maybe we are so stubborn as people that God has to physically allow us to suffer to get our attention. I've seen it. Maybe the second or the third reason is because you've never asked God for healing. That sounds silly, but if you, let me explain it this way. How many people have you heard, or maybe you're like that yourself, where you say, I don't want to pray about this because God's too busy, God's too big, or my prayers are too insignificant? Listen, if you think like that, if you think God's too busy for you or that your prayers are too insignificant for God, then you have a warped view of who God truly is, because the God of the Bible is strong enough, is powerful enough, is everywhere at once that he can pay 100% attention to you. If there was 100 trillion people on this earth, our God is powerful enough to give every one of those people 100% of his attention at the exact same time. Our God is not too busy for your prayers. So don't say, oh, well, God doesn't want to hear them. God wants to hear your prayers. In fact, in James chapter 4, verse 2, it says this, that you do not have because you do not ask God. Now, I'm not saying if you simply ask, you're gonna get healed, but have you ever thought, man, maybe I should pray about this? Instead of going to the doctors, going to friends, going to WebMD and all these other places, maybe I should first try going to God. Bible says you have not because you ask not. Interesting. The fourth reason, and we talked about it last week in great detail, so I'm not going to spend much time here, but the fourth reason that you may be going through suffering is simply spiritual demonic oppression. Now remember, as Christians, we cannot be possessed by the devil or by the demons because we have Christ in us, we have the Holy Spirit in us, so we are already occupied by God. So we, as Christians, cannot be possessed by demons, but we can be oppressed. The demons can come after us physically. And a great resource, a great way to just learn more about the enemy's tactics and to learn about this oppression, read the book of Job. Just read the book of Job. I think it's an interesting read. It may just help develop your theology, your understanding of God. So just think about that. Now, the fifth reason that God may allow you to go through suffering is for God's glory. For God's glory. Well, that sounds weird of God. Well, let's actually look at it. Anybody recognize this guy up on the screen? Maybe you've seen him on TV, maybe you've seen him on the internet, maybe you've YouTubed him. Well, if you don't know him, write down that name and go Google him later. Watch some of his videos. Very inspirational guy. But let me go ahead and let me read a little bit of his biography, so to speak. His name is Nick something. Lydia knows how to pronounce it. Ask her, okay? But look at what he says. He says, when I was 10 years old, Nick says this, he says, I was bitter towards God. I attempted suicide through drowning myself in the bathtub. So he is just angry at God. He said, I felt that there was no purpose in my life. And when you lack purpose and strength, it is hard to hold on. Later in his life, though, he says, but with the help of my religion, my friends, and my family, Nick managed to pull through, and now he has become an international symbol of triumph over adversity. Now he is a motivational speaker and has traveled to over 24 countries, speaking to some groups that are well over 100,000 people at one time. Born with no arms, no legs, if anybody has a reason to be discouraged, you know what? He might be top on that list. But look at what he says. After he ended up giving his life to Christ and asking Christ to be his Lord and Savior and living for the Lord, look at what he says. He says, I realized why God had made me like this. I realized like why I was born this way. And he said the reason is to give hope to others. It was so inspirational to me that I decided to use my life to encourage other people and give them the courage that God has given me. I decided to be thankful for what I have and not get angry at God for what I don't. It's incredible that he took what God had given him and he used it for his glory. How many people have been inspired by this man up on the screen? And they said, well, if God can give him hope, then I want that same type of hope. If God can work through him, then surely God can work through me. We don't know the amount of people who have given their life to Christ because of this man. You know, there's this man in the Bible named the Apostle Paul. He wrote most of the New Testament. And he was like the best pedigree. He loved the Lord. He lived for the Lord. He served God just ferociously for Christ. But look at what the Bible says happened to him. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 through 10, it says this. Paul's writing and he says, listen, to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surprisingly great revelation, meaning all the things that God had him write and all that good stuff, because God was really speaking to him. He said, in order to keep me humble, there was given to me a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. Now, we don't know what that was. We don't know if it was an eye injury. Some people think it was. Maybe it was like just some kind of back pain, something that he couldn't physically remove himself. And so what did he did? He did what most of us, in fact, what all of us do. It says this up on the screen. It says, three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. He said, God, please heal me. God, please heal me. God, please heal me. Just like we pray all the time. But look at what it says. This is what the Lord said to him. It said, but he said to me, this is God speaking. He said, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So Paul writes, therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness so that Christ's power may rest upon me. And that is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, I'm strong. What Paul's saying is, he's saying, listen, when I can't do it in my own strength because of my physical ailments, because of my suffering, just because of areas where I fall short, guess what? That's where God moves in, and that's when God just shows up. And it's through my weaknesses that God's name is made great. And so when you look at your weakness, maybe God is using your weakness to further his glory, to share about him more to more people through you. The sixth reason that maybe God's allowing suffering in your life is because God has something better for you. Or maybe God has something better for others. My wife, we've been to the doctor many times, we've been to hospitals, we've been to just places because of, you know, not only her birth, not only having a child, but other ailments or other reasons to go to the doctor in her life. So it's been interesting though, that when we talk to these nurses, when we talk to these doctors, some of them almost are taken back that we're Christian. When they see us praying, or when they see us or hear us talking about Christ, they ask us, are you a Christian? And we'll tell them, yeah, we're Christians. And it's incredible to see how God will use us to just start conversations. I end up giving many of them my phone number, saying, hey, I'm a pastor at church, here's my number, you ever wanna come hang out? We're here on Sundays. And they may not show up at church, but they'll text me when things go wrong in their life. They'll say, hey, my uncle's going through this. Hey, I'm going through this. Hey, this person, they don't have the results they're hoping for on their test. Can you pray for them? Because it looks cancerous. And so God has been using us through Katie to further his gospel. You guys remember this guy up on the screen? Isaiah? About a year ago, we met this young boy. He was 7 years old at the time, up in Montana, the power of the internet. We got connected, and it turns out that he was suffering in his heart. His heart literally had holes in it. And so God used this church to help them financially, to love on them, to pray for them. And you know what was interesting about this young man? And that's him and his mom when they had to take an emergency plane ride over to Seattle. So it was an 8-hour trip. What was interesting about this is when I got to talk to the parents, they told me, they said, you know, God has used us through this in more ways than we could ever imagine. We've been able to share Jesus with the nurses, with the doctors, with other patients. And they say, people are so amazed at how peaceful we are, even though it seems like our world's falling apart. Why? Because they have a relationship with God, and God is using them to further his name through their boy's suffering. So when you're suffering, maybe look around and say, okay, how is God gonna use this in my life? God, how do you want to use me to further your kingdom? You know, what's interesting is that human trafficking is a very hot topic issue. I read recently about this man who went through human trafficking, and he said it was so bad that his own family members sold him into slavery. It was that bad. And in fact, not only did it end there for him, but as he was being humanly trafficked, that he went from being slavery to ending up in prison. Not because he did anything wrong, it just somehow he ended up there. And so as he was in prison, though, the Lord's hand was upon him. And he started to elevate him. In fact, he got such a reputation in jail that the warden said, listen, I've got too much on my plate. I'm going to hand you some responsibilities. I'm going to put you in charge. And you're just not above me, but you're in charge of jail. And so that was incredible. Well, the politicians of that country found out about this young man in jail. And they said, wow, if God's doing that for him there, let's bring him up with us and maybe God will bless us through him. So sure enough, the politicians brought him up and they started putting him in positions of authority. And before you know it, he was well, high in a position of authority. And God started to use him and that country started to change. In fact, it was so incredible that God worked on that heart and God told this young man, he said, listen, I need you to tell the guys ahead of you that there is a deep famine coming. You're going to have some time of prosperity, but I am going to bring a big famine on your country. So what happened was that this young man who was a part of human trafficking, who was sold into slavery, who was in jail for a while, who moved up the ranks because God's hand was upon him, told the politicians, and guess what? They said, okay, you're in charge then. You prepare the country for this. Well, if you ever want to read about this story, you can actually turn to Genesis, because this is the story of Joseph. Joseph, turns out that his brothers, later on in life, found him. And they realized he wasn't dead. Because they thought, okay, we sold him, and he's going to die. We just don't like him. But it turns out that God had his hand upon Joseph the whole time. And look at what it says. When his brothers finally approached him during that time of famine, look at what Joseph said. He said, and now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here. Look at what he says. He says, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. Do you realize that? That Joseph, if anybody, could probably complain, but he said, no, God has a purpose, and his purpose was to send me ahead of the people so that I could prepare and save lives when this great, disastrous famine takes place. So maybe God has something better for you or through you. Now, the seventh reason is maybe God is growing your faith. Maybe God wants you to trust him more through your suffering. This next verse up on the screen looks good on fridges, looks good on desktops, looks good in office, but do you really apply it to your life? Look at what Proverbs chapter 3, 5 through 6 says. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him and he will make your path straight. What is that saying? It's saying when you don't understand what's going on, when you don't get the big picture, when you don't have the answers, when things don't make sense, trust in the Lord. Because even though you don't see it, even though we may not get what's going on, God says, I do. Trust me. I know what's going on. I know what you're feeling. I know what we're going through. I haven't forgotten about you. Trust me. Look at this next verse. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. Look at what it says. It says, cast all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Do you realize that? That God cares about you so much. He says, listen, I'm like a dartboard. Just throw it all on me. I want to hear from you. I want you to vent. I want you to be honest with me. If you're mad, be mad. If you're angry, be angry. If you just want to cuss me out, cuss me out. Let me work with you. Be honest, and then that'll be a starting point, and we'll work from there. But whatever you're going through, God says, just throw it on me. Because if we're honest, God already knows. He's just waiting for us to work in that relationship. Now, finally, the last reason that I could think of that God allows suffering in our lives is to possibly help others or serve others. See, suffering allows you to relate to somebody who's going through the same thing that you've either going through or have been through better than if you had never gone through it. Cancer patients. Cancer patients can relate to other cancer patients better than somebody who's never had cancer. Guys who have been in war, who have war injuries, who have post-traumatic stress disorder, they can relate a whole lot better to someone else who has had that than I could. I can listen to them, I can pray for them, but I cannot relate to them at the level that they are at as well as somebody else who's been through that level or at that level. Now, I have a hurt back. My back hurts, I've herniated disc, had the surgery, all that. All right, sciatica, back pain, I've had it all. Sometimes it flares up. I get back pain. I can relate to somebody with back pain, and I can be a whole lot more sympathetic than if I never had it. People say, hey, will you pray for me? My back hurts. Oh man, I'm in. I get it. I can relate. I can help. I can serve. I can pray better for them. And I'm sure things that you've gone through can relate to people who also gone through it. You know, there's something about women who have gone through birth. There's something about women who have gone through the pregnancy, who have given birth, the whole labor, all the nine yards, okay? If you ever watch them, you see two women who have given birth kind of walking past each other and give each other the nod like, we know, we feel each other. They give them everything but the fist bump, you know what I mean? And it's funny because there's been times in my life, and I've heard other women saying it, so you husbands know, you women know, okay. Well, there's been times where me, for example, or other men have said, oh man, my back hurts, oh, my feet hurt, oh man, I got this headache. And we men will play it to such a level, maybe try and get some sympathy. But you know what? When women have had enough, you know the card that they play? It's like the best hand in life. It's like the best hand in poker. They say, yeah, but you've never given birth. And you can't beat that because we haven't. We didn't do anything. We just stood there and said, hey, it's okay. You'll be done, you know? And not that that's necessarily a bad thing, but women can relate to women a whole lot better during that time than men can. We're just kind of supportive and hope we don't say anything stupid. But it's incredible how God will allow you to go through suffering. Well, God will allow you to go through pains in order that maybe later in life you can relate to somebody who's been there. In fact, I know I joke a little about women giving birth and pregnancy, but I tell you this though, is that it's incredible to see a woman who's never given birth before, who's close to giving birth, and to see a woman who's had multiple births or even one, be able to comfort her in an incredible way. It's actually a very beautiful thing to see how God works in people's lives. So just know that maybe the suffering you're going through is to help somebody out later in life. Now, as we talk about suffering, guys, there may be nobody who you feel can relate to your pain. Nobody's experiencing the things I experience. Well, if we're honest with ourselves, there is somebody. His name's Jesus Christ. He not only experienced the physical suffering, but he also experienced the spiritual, even emotional suffering. Let's play the picture. Let's push rewind. Play it back again, guys. See, the Bible says that Jesus went through a lot of physical suffering before he even got to the cross. Things he went through. The guards, man, they spit on him. They pulled his beard. They beat him. They insulted him. They not only did that, but they gambled for his clothes. And it didn't end there. They took a crown of thorns, sharp thorns, and they shoved it in his head. In fact, it was so bad that they couldn't push it down with their hands. They had to take sticks and dive it into his scalp because they didn't want to hurt their hands. He got whipped time and time again by what they say a cat of nine tails, which is a whip, and at the end of that whip is nine little small whips, and at the end of those little small whips, there is shards of glass or bone tied to it, so that every time this person gets whipped, it digs into the skin, and when that man who's whipping him pulls it back, they didn't just whip him once, but they whipped him time and time and time again, and that wasn't enough. Then, on top of all that, they made him carry his own cross, his own torture device, this same piece of wood that he's gonna be crucified to. They made him carry it up a hill. In fact, he got so exhausted, it was so bad that someone else had to step in and carry it up there. And when they finally got to the top of the mountain, the top of the hill, guess what? They crucified Jesus. They put nails, one arm, a nail in the other, and then they put his feet on top of that, one on top of the other, and they put a nail through that. This wasn't just like taking a nail through jello, okay? It wasn't one shot, one hit, you're done. No, imagine what the effort it takes to put a nail through 2 feet. Imagine that. And then at that point, if Jesus can't relate to us enough already, it was on the cross that the biggest pain came. In fact, it was so bad for Jesus that God had to turn away and said, I can't look. It's that bad. Because on the cross, all of God's wrath, all of God's anger towards sin, the same sin that each one of us commit, the same sin that all of humanity has done, all of our sins, at that point in time was poured upon Christ with such ferociousness, with just fury, that Jesus cried out. See, it wasn't the pain, the physical pain that Jesus was worried about in the garden when he prayed, Lord, if you can take this from me, take it. It wasn't the physical he was worried about, because there's been a lot of people before Jesus was ever born that died physical suffering deaths. But it was the wrath of God that was about to be poured on him that would cause such suffering, such pain that Jesus was very hesitant about. And he did that for all of us. Because it was by doing that and that alone that God was able to provide the one and only bridge between us and heaven named Jesus Christ. That's why Jesus said in John 14:6, he said, I'm the way, I'm the truth, and I'm the life. No one gets to the Father who's in heaven but through me. Jesus realized that. And that's why Jesus said, I don't want to go to the cross, but I will, because I love man enough that I want to provide a bridge for them. See, our sin has separated us from God. In fact, we are so separated from him, it's like a Grand Canyon between us and God. No matter how many times we try and jump and make the leap, we're always gonna fall short. But God said, listen, I know you can't get to me in heaven, but I can get to you because I love you so much, and I'm gonna get to you by my son, Jesus Christ. See, I tell people, we all are gonna stand before God. We all make it to heaven. But only one key gets us in the door, and that's Jesus Christ. We all stand before God. We're all gonna see God. But only one key gets you into that eternal paradise called heaven, and that's Jesus Christ. Praise God for those who accept Jesus Christ. One of the blessings is not only do we get the satisfaction of knowing that when we die, we go to heaven. Not only do you get the satisfaction that, hey, Jesus said that the life I live, man, I'm gonna have some blessings in this life here on earth. Not only do we get to go to heaven when we die, but when we die, guess what? We get new bodies in heaven. The bodies that don't have herniated discs, the bodies that don't have ankle pains, the bodies that don't have infections, that don't have all these type of diseases. Man, we get new bodies in heaven. I don't know if it's our body reinvigorated. I don't know if we get completely new bodies, but who cares? We get new bodies. Amen? Amen. So here's what I want you to do, church. Here's how I want you to respond from this message. I want you to do what this verse says up on the screen. Because this is the key to getting that peace that passes all understanding. The key that when your world's falling apart, man, you can have peace. When things are going down, when you should be complaining, people look at you and say, man, you're more messed up than me. Why are you not suffering? Why are you not cursing God? Why are you not complaining? And then you can say, well, man, this is what I've been doing. It says this up on the screen. It says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, guys, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. What it's saying is this. When you're suffering, pray about it. When you're suffering, when you're going through trials, when you're going through whatever, pray about it. When your world's falling apart, pray about it. Why? Because as you pray, God will work on your heart. He'll work on your heart through verses in the Bible. He'll work on your heart through circumstances around you. He'll work on your heart through people. Well, how so? Well, maybe you'll meet somebody who can help calm your heart and let you know it's gonna be okay. Maybe there's gonna be circumstances where God used you and you realize, okay, maybe this is why God's allowing me to go through suffering. Maybe there's verses in your life that the Holy Spirit will bring to remembrance. One, for example, is where you're suffering and you read something along the lines where it says that our lives are but vapors in the wind, here today, gone tomorrow. And then you start to think about it, you say, well, I'm gonna be around for another 40 years, and I may have this back pain, I may have this ailment for 40 more years, but really when you look at that verse, in the light of all eternity, man, 40 years compared to eternity in heaven, man, that's like but the twinkle of an eye. Okay, I'm in it now, these 40 years are gonna seem like forever, but I tell you what, when I'm in heaven, it's okay. We're gonna be good. It's not as bad as I thought. So just pray about it. Allow God to talk to you. Allow God to refine you. Allow God to speak to you through this trial. Here's what I want you to understand, guys. Here's the bottom line of today's message. That Christ is in the center of your crisis. He knows what you're going through. He knows what you're suffering. He knew it was going to happen before it happens. And he knows how long it's going to take place. But guys, just do me a favor. Repeat this after me. Just all one loud and proud big voice. Just repeat this. Christ is in the center of your crisis. Remember that. Let's pray. I'm going to ask the music team to come up and get ready to bless us with the song. And guys, as we think about our suffering, as we think about the things that we're going through, know that God is right there with us. He's walking with us. Why not me, Lord? Why haven't you healed me yet? Well, maybe some of the reasons today are why God hasn't healed you. Or maybe God has something special planned for you. Or maybe God has a totally different reason of why he hasn't healed you. Pray to God. Talk about it. Get that peace that passes all understanding that comes through that communication, that relationship with prayer. And church, understand this, that as we're praying and our heads are bowed and the song's about to sing, I'm going to be back there. Katie's going to be back there. If you need prayer, guys, we're there for you. We'll pray with you right now. But we just want you to know and to cling to God and to just work on your relationship with him, because it's through that relationship that God brings the comfort, that God brings the peace, that God brings the understanding of why you're going through what you're going through. So guys, if you need prayer, we're going to be in the back. Lord, whatever's going on in our hearts, Lord, let us act upon it proper. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Guys, they're about to sing this song. And I asked them to sing this song because it goes so well with the message today. But there's a particular line in there, because I learned about this song. A man had cancer and he kept getting this cancer. He got healed and he'd come back. He got healed and come back. He got healed and come back. He finally died. And at his funeral, one of his requests was to play this song, because he realized that God was working through him. And there's a particular line in there that says, Lord, if this is what it takes to bring you glory, then God, bring the rain, bring the suffering, bring the pain. Because if this is what it takes to give you glory, God, then God, bring the rain. As they're playing, if you need prayer, we're going to be back here for you guys.
I can count a million times people asking me how I praise you with all that I've gone through. Question just amazes me, and circumstances possibly change who I forever am in you. Maybe since my life has changed, long before these rainy days, it's never really ever crossed my mind to turn my back on you, oh Lord, my only shelter from the storm. But instead, I draw closer through these times. So I chance to be free. Bring me anything that brings you glory. And I know there'll be days when this life brings me pain. But if that's what it takes to praise you, Jesus, bring the rain. Regardless of the clouds that may loom above, because you are much greater than my pain. You made a way for me by suffering your death.
destiny. So tell me, what's a little ring? So I pray, bring me joy, bring me peace, bring the chance to be free, bring me anything that brings your glory. And I know there'll be days when this life brings you pain, but if that's what it takes to praise you, Jesus, bring the rain. Jesus, bring the rain. And I'll forever sing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Is the Lord God Almighty. Everybody singing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Is the Lord God Almighty.
Amen. Let's pray.